Trump versus Twitter. El presidente de Estados Unidos firmó una orden ejecutiva para regular las redes sociales. Dijo que es para defender la libertad de expresión. Conmoción por la muerte de George Floyd. Hubo fuertes protestas en varias ciudades de Estados Unidos luego de que este hombre negro falleciera tras ser arrestado. Un video muestra a un policía con la rodilla sobre el cuello de Floyd. China aprueba ley de seguridad para Hong Kong. La controvertida legislación permite que China continental tenga un mayor control sobre Hong Kong. Nissan cierra su planta en Barcelona. La compañía automotriz realiza una reestructuración radical y reducirá su capacidad de producción un 20%. Estas y otras noticias las pueden encontrar en cnne.com.
Welcome to another Unfiltered From Home. I'm Essie Cupp. While Trump tweets, America burns. As we approach a truly gruesome milestone of 100,000 deaths from COVID-19 in America, a pandemic the president was unprepared for and has misled us about from the beginning, he's melting down on his favorite platform. On Twitter, where he has 80 million followers, Trump has gone on late-night Twitter rages to vent into space about delusional conspiracy theories, old grudges, and new beefs. The president has lied on Twitter. He's threatened people on Twitter. Just over Memorial Day, he accused an American citizen of murder on Twitter. I've said it before, and I'll say it again. The president of the United States is not well, folks. He's done stuff that would get you and I kicked off of Twitter, our accounts suspended. Ordinary people who don't have 80 million followers are punished for even perceived offenses. I've seen it happen to a number of my friends. But Trump gets away abusing the platform every time. Well, this time Twitter is fighting back, sort of. It slapped a tiny warning on two of Trump's tweets. These made false statements about mail-in voting. The tag read, "Get the facts about mail-in voting." You can see it here if you look really closely at my phone. And then it linked to a statement headlined, "Trump makes unsubstantiated claim that mail-in ballots will lead to voter fraud." Now, Twitter did not delete Trump's inaccurate tweets. They certainly didn't ban him or even suspend him from the platform. But this innocuous little baby action, basically, Twitter asked to have a word with Trump's manager, predictably got him all kinds of riled up. He took to Twitter, of course, to launch a series of threats to do something he cannot do. He tweeted, "Republicans feel that social media platforms totally silence conservative voices. We will strongly regulate or close them down before we can ever allow this to happen again. We saw what they attempted to do and failed in 2016. We can't let a more sophisticated version of that happen again." Okay, to be clear, Trump cannot close down Twitter. Nonetheless, the message he is sending should deeply disturb Republicans in Congress who have long argued against censorship projects like the Fairness Doctrine and net neutrality, who have fought the censorship by social media outlets like Twitter and have argued against regulating the internet. Now, of course, Trump Republicans are siding with Trump. Kellyanne Conway invited Trump supporters to harass the Twitter employee who is in charge of its fact-checking, as did a number of far-right media outlets. One Republican congressman from Florida lambasted the website for daring to fact-check the president at all. A Fox Business panel shouted angrily at the move by Twitter. Senator Marco Rubio wants Twitter to now be treated like a publisher, to, quote, no longer be shielded from liability and treated as publishers under the law. Right, so the president of the United States lies, threatens, and defames American citizens on Twitter. That's all fine. The president of the United States attacks that same platform and threatens to shut down a private company. That's also totally fine. But the website offers a little fact check to his misleading statements, and that's the thing that gets Republicans bent out of shape. Here's the bottom line. Using Twitter is a privilege, not a right. It should be used responsibly. The president has abused the privilege over and over again. He's used it to spread dangerous and false information, like the non-existent benefits of hydroxychloroquine and disinfectants to stave off coronavirus, as well as baseless conspiracy theories and defamatory statements. He's used it to tweet and retweet anti-Semitic tropes, anti-immigrant tropes, racist rhetoric. He's used it to unleash an army of supporters and bots to harass his critics. And yet the president still enjoys the privilege of using this website. Warnings on his tweets are the least, and I mean the very least, Twitter should do. If I were them, I'd kick him right off.
Why you stop me? Why you stop me? Tell me why you stop me. Hey, tell him why you stop me.
Get back.
What's your reason to stop me?
Show us your hands right now. Show us.
What's your reason to stop me?
Listen. Listen.
What's your reason to stop me?
Driver, exit the vehicle now.
If there's another unit available, can we get someone, please?
Step back, dude. Come back here. Just walk back. You're not.
Why you stop me? Why you stop me? Why you stop me?
Okay. Walk back. Walk back.
Why you stop me? Why you stop me?
Put your guns down. Put the guns down. I'm scared.
Okay. No, put the guns up.
I'm scared.
He don't got nothing on him.
Put the guns down.
Stay right there, baby. Stay right there.
Wes, is there anyone else in the vehicle?
Which vehicle was he driving?
Charger?
I can't see. I can't tell.
Okay, let's go.
Watch the vehicle.
I got hands. Watch the vehicle.
I just want to make sure I have the weapons on him first. Okay, let's get him and move on.
Get him on.
Walk that way. I'll check him once we get in the jail. Man.
Go through what happened yesterday for us? Yes, ma'am. I was leaving the installation. I was coming back from an appointment, heading home over to Platte City. I was coming up to the bridge. I knew there was construction going on the bridge. I saw that there was a vehicle stopped ahead of me. A man was out of his vehicle, which was a suspect. It appeared that he was just getting something out of his vehicle. I didn't know what was going on as I was pulling up. I was talking to my fiance at the time on my Bluetooth speaker in my truck, and as I was talking to her, the man pulled up a rifle and started aiming towards eastbound across the river towards the Missouri side and began to shoot off some rounds. Immediately told my fiance to call 911, that there was an active shooter on the bridge, and I told her I had to go. I assessed the situation very quickly, looked around, and just took the only action possible that I felt I could take, and I accelerated my truck as quickly as possible and struck the active shooter and pinned him underneath my truck. I wasn't necessarily frightened. I was shocked that it was happening, and the adrenaline took over, and with the military training that I've received, I took appropriate action as I seen, and took out the threat as fast as possible. After the incident was over, I was pretty calm. I was kind of dealt with situations similar. Not exactly like this. You can't really deal with the situation. Everything's based off its own merits. But when I got home, I just wanted to get home, get everything back to normal, get to my kids, give them a hug. And then I went, I mowed my grass and ate dinner and spent time with my family. A lot of phone calls, a lot of people thanking me. And it's pretty surreal.